I am very glad to be here today at this conference to honor the contributions of Thibaut and also to say happy birthday, Thibaut. So in this contribution, we shall discuss some adventures in post-Newtonian theory. And of course, I will highlight the seminal contributions of Thibaut in this field. And I will also describe some of our common contributions. Essentially dating from the back from the 80s and 90s, and actually starting almost 40 years ago already with my PhD thesis in Meudon Observatory, which was advised by Thibaut at the time. So at that time, early 80s. There was a lot of theoretical developments in equations of motion and gravitational radiation, but that was essentially motivated at the time by the Hulse-Taylor binary pulsar, which was discovered a few years before in 1974. And so many of the motivation were to explain the wonderful observation of the orbital p dot of the binary pulsar, which is due to gravitational radiation. And in 1982, there was a Les Ouches conference organized by Nathalie de Ruel and Zvi Piran on gravitational radiation. And in the proceedings of this conference, in this book, edited in 1982, there is a series of very interesting and important and seminal papers, including an introduction by Kipson on gravitational radiation, and most importantly, an important paper by Thibaut on gravitational waves and the motion of compact bodies, where he gives the recent results for equations of motion, which were at the time referred to as the Paris contribution, or the contribution from the Paris group, essentially Thibaut and Nathalie, and also Louis Bell and some others, maybe. And there is a series of papers for the future direct search and analysis of gravitational waves. And at the time, the detectors LIGO and VIRO were just starting their wonderful career. And interestingly enough, there is, in the end of this book, a roundtable discussion, which was moderated by Abbé Hachteka on gravitational waves and equations of motion and the binary pulsar interpretation. And so there was a few talks here. There was a recall by Kip on the standard argument which gives the prediction for the Hulse-Taylor binary pulsar, the p-dot, and in agreement with observations. There was a short paper by Bernard Schutz on gravitational radiation reaction, work that he had done with Futamase. And there is Thibaut's outlining the contribution of the Paris group. And according to Abbé Hachteka, by the way, this roundtable is still worth to read nowadays. It's very interesting, and the whole book is still very interesting to reread now. And according to the moderator, the discussions were very lively, and at some claims by Thibaut, there was a protest from the audience. So this is still very much worth to read. So the equations of motion, which motivated, say, by the binary pulsar, but now motivated by gravitational wave detections, you have the motion of two point masses, and you will work out this in the post-Newtonian approximation, and therefore you will set a Newtonian representation of the equations of motion at some with some given post-Newtonian precision. And so this means that you will choose a coordinate system and then consider the equations for the coordinate velocities and acceleration in that coordinate system and express the acceleration of a body in terms of a bunch of Newtonian plus post-Newtonian corrections. At order 1 pn, v over c square, I use the terminology introduced by Chandrasekhar, then you will have effects which imply the precession, the orbital precession of the body. This will be still a correction which is what we call conservative, that is, there will be conserved energy in the system implied by these equations of motion, and more generally, there will be conservation of angular momentum, linear momentum, center of mass position. That is, we shall have the 10 invariants associated with the 10 symmetries of the Poincaré group, but of course, these symmetries are approximate in a sense of the post-Newtonian expansion, consistently with the order that you are considering. Up to 2pn order, this is still conservative. But then, at 2.5pn order, there will be a small radiation reaction term, which is responsible for the p dot of the binary system, the effect observed in the binary pulsar. So there will be a shrink of the orbit, an inspiral of the orbit. And this is the effect that we call now the chirp of the orbit of the system, which is observed by gravitational waves. And for gravitational waves, you need to go much beyond that. 3pn, still conservative, 1pn correction to the radiation reaction. And then at 4pn order, there has been a lot of work recently on 4pn, you have conservative effects, and then you have also a dissipative effect. And actually, there is a contribution from a tail term, a non-linear effect, due to scattering of gravitational waves on the space-time, which is curved by the source itself, and which implies a conservative and a dissipative contribution at that order. So the equations of motion were developed starting from the early days of GR, and in Lesouches' lecture, Thibault points out that the first derivation correct of the equations of motion at 1pn order is that of Lorentz and Drost. And these authors found also, in particular, the Lagrangian, a Lagrangian associated with the motion. Remind that this is completely conservative at that order. And so if you use Euler-Lagrange equation with that Lagrangian, you will obtain equations of motion, but there is a caveat to that. You will get accelerations in 1pn terms, and these accelerations, once you have varied the Lagrangian, you can replace it by equations of motion, that is, you order reduce your result, so that, finally, the acceleration that you get is just a functional of position and velocities of the bodies, including the bodies that you are considering, and so this is the equations of motion. Now, at 2pn order, at 1pn order, there is also the famous EIH paper, which was actually much older in the late 30s. And this is a famous paper. Actually, the first one was almost forgotten. This is true for, this is valid for n particles. And this derivation is nice because actually it derives the equations of motion from the vacuum Einstein field equations. So the equations of motion of a body is obtained from a two-surface integral surrounding the body. So independently of the internal structure of the body, it can be a black hole or a neutron star or some more exotic object. It doesn't matter. And these equations are extensively used for the solar system dynamics at 1pn order for the motion of n planets. Another interesting derivation of the equations of motion is by Fock using extended compact objects. So, this is for the motion of the center of mass of such objects at 1pn order. And there is a thing which I like with this work, and there is the book of Fock is a very nice book to read. But there is one thing which is very useful for us, is the introduction of this particular kernel, which is extremely important for PN calculation at high order, and which solves that equation, 1 over R1, R2. R1 and R2 are the distances, and And the solution is a log of the perimeter of this triangle made with the two source points, the two compact objects, and the field point at which you are looking for the effect. 2PN order, things become much more complicated. There was a series of papers by the Japanese school who proposed to use the ADM Hamiltonian formalism in general relativity to do PN calculations, and they tackled the 2PN equations of motion. And then there is a beautiful series of papers by Thibault and Nathalie. So they start by pointing out some errors in the previous paper by the previous authors, conceptual errors, for instance, replacement of accelerations in the Lagrangian, which is illicit. And there is one coefficient, there was a computational error in one of the coefficients. The work DD uses DD coordinates, that is, de Donder coordinates, also known as harmonic coordinates. An interesting finding of DD is that at 2PN order in DD coordinates, the Lagrangian is no longer an ordinary Lagrangian, depending on position and velocities, but also depends on acceleration. And if you want to stay in the coordinate system, harmonic or DD coordinates, then you have to take into account this Lagrangian dependence on acceleration and use generalized variation, generalized Euler-Lagrange equations. And at the level of the equations of motion, then you can replace your accelerations by equations of motion consistently with the PN approximation. And they include the 2.5 PN radiation reaction term as well. There was an Hamiltonian derivation of the equations of motion by Thibault and Gerhard Schaeffer. There has been an extended body derivation also using extended fluid bodies and considering the compact limit of the bodies, that is the size when the size of the bodies tends to zero. This is a very nice approach. It's very difficult to high in high post-Newtonian approximation, but already at 1PN or 2PN order, there is a problem which is difficult to solve, which is to prove that in the compact body limit, you will have the gravitational self-energy contribution in the bodies which diverge, and so you have to prove that all these divergent terms can be renormalized in the definition of the dressed mass of the two bodies, so that finally, at the end, you recover the result computed with point masses. And there has been some direct post-Newtonian method up to 2.5 PN for the equations of motion and the metric. So let me just flash a few statements about higher order equations of motion, 3PN, 4PN, and even more. So there has been a lot of works at 3PN order in the late 90s, early 2000, starting with two groups, the group of Yaranovsky and Schaeffer, Piotr and Gerhard, and then Thibault joining the group, and our group with Guillaume Fay and Bala. But the problem is that we found, both groups found that there are ambiguity parameters in the problem. And these ambiguities are due to divergence in the problem that are associated with the fact that you have point particles, UV-type divergences. And then, in one of the DGS papers, the dimensional regularization was introduced into the field. It comes from, of course, it is well known in quantum field theory, but that was, I think, the first time that it was used for just PN expansion in classical GR, and this solves the problem of ambiguities. And at 4PN order, you have UV divergences solved by dimensional regularization, as well as infrared regularizations, and the problem is then more difficult. Infrared regularization, you need also dimensional regularization to regularize them, and in the DGS approach, there was, as a consequence of that, one regularization left, ambiguity left, which was fixed by GSF calculations, gravitational cell force calculation. And probably Piotr will describe that in his lecture. Our group here used a Lagrangian, what we call the Fokker Lagrangian, and used dimensional regularization for both UV and infrared divergences, and as a result, the computation was absolutely complete without any ambiguity at the end. So, the equations of motion were motivated by the binary pulsar. The binary pulsar is just the effect of the radiation reaction term at 2.5 pn. And so you see that you need equations of motion up to that order for the binary pulsar in principle. But the derivation of the effect was done before using the quadrupole formula, the Einstein quadrupole formula, and just a basic energy balance argument, flux balance equation, relating the flux to the loss of energy in the source. And the result is this formula, which has been worked out from the quadrupole formula by Landau Lifshitz in the circular case and by Peters and Matthews for eccentric orbits. And so you have two derivations, the one which is, in a sense, a little bit heuristic, but the complete physics is there, which is based on flux balance equation plus the quadrupole formula, and the one of Thibault and Nathalie, deriving the effect with equations of motion to 2.5 pn order. And actually, this, I would say, resolved the long-standing radiation reaction controversy at that time. Another nice thing in a paper by Thibault and Nathalie, again motivated by the binary pulsar at that time, was a nice representation of the motion of two compact objects at 1 pn order, which is called the quasi-Keplerian representation of the motion. And their idea is to write the motion in a quasi-Keplerian way, but introducing several types of parameters which generalize the usual notion of eccentricity and semi-major axis of the orbit. So you write this equation in a very familiar way from the Kepler equation, the radial equation, the azimuthal equation, but you introduce several types of eccentricities and the precession, k, orbital precession, and the mean motion or radial frequency, n. And all these parameters are linked, are related in a given way to the energy and angular momentum of the orbit. With, so this is valid in a class of coordinates, with n and k being the invariance, so given in terms of the energy and angular momentum. This representation is nice and it has been generalized up to higher order, and it has been useful for the binary pulsar and for other applications. Let me just flash here rapidly a recent application of that formalism and also some alternative Lagrangian and Hamiltonian formalism for the GR precession of an exoplanet. In this paper, it is shown that in the case of a particular exoplanet, which is remarkable and unique, with high eccentricity of the planet, and the planet is alone in this system. There are no other planets which will bring a perturbation to the effect. So that for this planet, the precession, the GR precession is the dominant effect for the precession. There are no other planets disturbing the effect. And so it can be shown that with observation by the Spitzer satellite of the interval, time interval between a transit of the planet in front of its star and the previous eclipse of the planet by the star. So there is a precise measurement in 2010. And then in 2024, when there will be GWST and the satellite Ariel to take measurement of that planet, the distance, the time interval between transit and anti-transit or eclipse will have decreased by about 300 second, and this will be measurable. And this is completely attributable to the GR effect. So you have to compute in detail all the transit times and entry of the transit, end of transit, and so on, for all these using our equations. So for gravitational waves, we shall, the detectors observe the famous chirp of gravitational waves. This is a chirp in the case of black hole system. This is the signal in the case of neutron star binaries. And traditionally, we can distinguish several phases into the chirp. There is the initial phase called the inspiraling phase. And in that phase, we can, in GR, use the post-Newtonian approximation because the inspiral during that phase is exactly given by a post-small, there is a diabetic parameter in the spiral, which is exactly small in a post-Newtonian sense. And you can use point-particle approximation in GR. And in that phase, the signal will be universal. It does not depend on the nature of the compact object. It can be black holes or more exotic object, it doesn't matter. The signal will be exactly the same. It is the same as for neutron star binaries. And this is due to a property in GR, which is called the effacing principle. And Thibault has emphasized this feature very much, in particular in his Lesouches lecture. And this effacing principle of the internal structure of the object, that is the equations of motion and the gravitational radiation, depends only on the masses and possibly the spins of the object, but not the internal structure, for instance, not the compacity parameter, that is the ratio between the mass and the radius of the object. And this is a I would say, a phase facet of the equivalence principle, the strong version of the equivalence principle, satisfied by GR. Essentially, if you have two compact objects, then the acceleration of a compact object in the field of the other one will be independent of the nature of the compact object, even if the gravity is strong. And so a compact object will feel the mass of the object, the other object, using, for instance, the Birkhoff theorem. And now we have the late in spiral. There will be some effect due to the internal structure. And then the merger and post-merger, which is very complicated in the case of neutron star binaries. At the beginning of the merger, there is still an effect which is associated with the tidal deformation of the bodies. This is linked to the Love numbers of the two compact objects. By the way, the Love number is zero for black holes. This is indicated in his Lesouches review, Thibault's Lesouches review. And this effect of the internal structure of binary neutron star, which has been measured or constrained by LIGO-Virgo detectors, is a very small, formally, PN effect, 5 PN. But the point is that the coefficient in front, which is the polarizability parameter of the neutron star, can be very large indeed, of the order of 1,000, and therefore the effect is measurable. Okay, so, yes?
Two more minutes,
okay. So, in 2000, in 1982, I started my PhD, and Thibault, for my PhD, gave me the Thorne paper that you cannot see very well here. But in the Thorne's paper, Review of Modern Physics, there is an expression for the most general linearized solution of the vacuum Einstein field equation in terms of multiple moments. And my task for the PhD was to iterate this expression of the linear metrics that I rewrite here in more modern form. This is given as a multipolar series in terms of multiple moments, mass type and current type multiple moments. And I had to iterate that, but let me just say that at the time, the field was in a very bad, sad, and unsatisfying situation. There was many, the multiple moments at that time, for instance, this expression in Sord's paper were given by divergent integrals. At the time, a lot of PN iterations yielded divergent Poisson integrals, and non-linear effect in the propagation of wave tails, memory, and so on, were completely ignored. So we started the multipolar post-Minkowskian expansion. Multipolar expansion for each of the coefficients of a post-Minkowskian series, and we use a particular regularization to cope with the divergence of multiple expansion using a parameter, complex parameter, and analytic continuation in that parameter. And from that formula, so I think I will stop we add a lot of mathematical results, and so here is some of them. So we have general formulas to integrate the non-linearities of the Einstein-Field equation. We use symmetric trace-free harmonics in order to get such formulas. And I will probably finish with some more complicated formulas, which involves the Legendre function of the second kind, which is here, and this permits to compute tails and tails of tails with more complicated formulas. And I will just flash the results that we had in a series of papers regarding the tail effects. So the tails effects are due to the scattering of gravitational waves onto the space-time curvature associated with the mass of the source. And so there are two effects. Actually, there is a contribution from the tail which will propagate to infinity. This is, by the way, observable in LIGO-Virgo. And there is also a contribution in the for the equations of motion at 4pn order and the dynamics and the contribution to radiation reaction at 4pn order in the dynamics of the source. And since I have no longer time, I will stop here.
Thank you very much, Luc.
Okay.
So I think we have time for one question. Thibaut.
Just a side question. The exoplanet. We are talking purely about the GR effect, but the fact that the central star is extended, one is sure that there are no effects linked to the structure
yes.
of the star.
Yes, thank you very much. Yeah. So this effect is the dominant one. After that, you have an effect due to the tidal interaction between the planet and the star. And this effect is mainly, the main part of the effect is due to the planet itself, the tidal deformation of the planet and the Love number of the planet. And this is something like 30% of the GR effect. And if you take into account the tidal effect and include the internal structure of the star, this is negligible. And in this system, 20 years of observations have shown that there are no other planets, with a reasonable mass. So the system is very clean on that point of view. There is also another fact, is that this star is a double star, actually. There is another star, companion star, but which is very far away, and it has almost no effect.
Alessandro has a quick question.
Yes. No, I was just wondering if there is one thing that you didn't show that you wanted to show in a few seconds.
Well, I have still 20 slides to show.
So in 1 minute, it's most complicated.
The most important one.
Yes, okay.
The most important one. Something that is.
Okay, so thank you very much, Alessandra. I am glad. Okay. So there is a memory effect. Okay, so yes, I'd like just to say that. Well, for the moment, I just describe the MPM formalism that we did with Thibault. So this is an external field, but then you have to match it to the internal field. So you will do that using the theory of matched asymptotic expansions. And so this yields the MPM-PN formalism, sometimes called also the BDI formalism, after Thibault, Ballard, and myself. And the matching has been done to the first orders, 1PN and this is the so-called BD moments. It has been generalized by Thibault and Ballard for the current moments. But then there has been general matching between external field and near zone field, which gives you a formal solution valid to any post-Newtonian order and solving the matching equation for both the near zone field and the external field. And I will stop here. Basically, this is the solution that we are applying for practical computation of compact binaries using that these general formulas.
Very good. Thank you for last time to do it again.
Thank you very much.